Hello, good morning everyone. I am K. Narasimurthy, presently working as an assistant professor in Government First Aid Women's College, Tumkur. I am teaching physics and this is my 57th video for second semester students of Tumkur University. I have started a new chapter which is Network Theorem, which you have not at all studied in your pre-university level. This chapter is absolutely new for you students. So I introduced the network theorem and I have explained a very basic definitions of the network theorem in my the very first chapter video, and that was 55th video. After that I derived one important derivation, that was the Thevenin's theorem. I derived Thevenin's theorem in my previous video. And this is the second network theorem which I am going to discuss, which I am going to derive today. And the theorem was the superposition theorem. Let's get started with this theorem. Now, it states that in any linear bilateral network consists of two or more energy sources, the current or voltage in any part of the network is equal to the algebraic sum of current or voltage produced independently by each source. Okay, right. With the diagram, you can understand the things better. So I have given you the three figures, the one and two, this left hand side, and the three in the right hand side. Okay. So, in the statement, in the first sentence itself, a linear bilateral network consists of two or more energy sources. See, the two energy sources network is the first network. I have two energy sources. One is E1, another one is E2. The first network will have two energy sources. Okay, in that bilateral linear network consists of two or more energy sources. I am looking for current or voltage in any part of the network. Part of the network means you take this R1 resistor part or R2 resistor part or R3 resistor part. You take current or voltage in any of these components, or R1 or R2 or R3. See, I am looking for R3. Let us take one branch, so one part of the network, and that is R3. Look for the current at R3 with two batteries. With the two batteries, one is E1, another one is E2, and I am looking for the current which is flowing through the R3, and that is I, and that I is equal to algebraic sum of current or voltage produced independently by each source. Now let us take independently each source and look for the current across the same current element, which is R3. Now in the figure 2, I have only taken the battery E1 and I have shorted E2. So E2 is shorted, I have only taken E1 and I am looking for the current which is flowing through R3, and I called it as I2. The current flowing through R3 with only E1 is I2. And current flowing through R3 with only the battery E2 and E1 is shorted, and that current is I1. So according to this superposition theorem, it says that the I current which is flowing through R3 with both the batteries together is equal to I1 plus I2. I1 is the current flowing through R3 with only one battery E2, and I2 is the current flowing through R3 with only one battery E1. Okay, so with two batteries, you look for the current which is flowing through one circuit element, and you remove one battery and short circuit it and look for the current. You remove other battery and short circuit the another one and you look for the current. And these two currents, algebraic sum of these two currents will be equal to the current which is produced by both the batteries together across the same current element, across the same circuit element. Okay. So it simply says that I is equal to I1 plus I2. You know what is I and what is I1 and what is I2 is. I is the current flowing through R3 with two batteries together. I1 is the current which is flowing through R3 with one battery E1, say E1, and I2 is the current which is flowing through R3 with one battery E2. So independently produced currents, I1 and I2 is equal to current produced in that circuit element by two batteries together. Okay, right. You are doing an experiment of superposition theorem in the laboratory also. You are verifying this and you are looking for the current I and you are measuring the current I1 as well as I2 and you are verifying this superposition in the laboratory by measuring the current across the same circuit element. Right. So after the statement, let us go to the proof of this theorem. Yeah. Right. Now let us consider a linear network consists of two batteries. This time I have taken the two batteries and the three resistors. So this complex network and I am analyzing and I am looking for the current which is flowing through R3. Okay. With both the batteries together. So E1 and E2 are the two batteries. Together I am looking for the current which is flowing through R3. After that, let me see what I'll do. Okay. First, let us analyze this and look for the current which is flowing through R3. Now analyze this circuit using Kirchhoff voltage law. As I have done in the last previous video while discussing the Thevenin's theorem, I have used and I have explained how to use the Kirchhoff voltage law. Right. Now we have two loops here. The same one loop with the E1, R1, R3. And I have another loop with R3, R2, E2. So two loops are there. I am applying the Kirchhoff voltage law separately for these two loops. Let us get started with a one loop, loop one. So it says that KVL says that it is an sum of the product of current and resistance is equal to the EMF of the battery. Okay, so right. So one sign convention you need to understand here is, suppose if you are going in a clockwise direction and if current is also in your direction, then put plus. Suppose if you are going in clockwise and current is in the anti-clockwise, then you have to put minus sign. So be careful. And in the EMF, if you are going from positive to the negative, you have to put plus E1 in the right hand side. Right. You all know this, you all studied this Kirchhoff voltage law in the second PUC. Right. Let us apply KVL for the loop 1. Okay. Right. So here in the loop 1, I am going in a clockwise direction. I am going clockwise. Okay. So current is also luckily going clockwise. Current is also clockwise. I am considering, my consideration is also clockwise. So first I'll come to the resistance R1. At R1 I have to take I1 R1. So write I1 R1. Next I am coming to the resistor R3. Okay, what is the current through R3? It is I1 plus I2. Students, you need to understand the current here. Let us have some idea of how current is flowing in what direction. Okay, so E1 is the battery which is producing the current and I1 is the current which is flowing through R1 and it is coming down. Here E2 is another battery which is producing the current and the current flowing to R2 is I2 and it is also coming down through R3. So I have two currents, I1 and I2, both are coming down to the R3. Now the current through R3 is I1 plus I2. Okay, so current through R3 is I1 plus I2. Now I am applying KVL across R3. Now current through this is I1 plus I2. I1 plus I2 into R3 is equal to E1. So why I am writing plus E1, it's because I am going from positive of the battery to the negative. Okay, so which is positive here? The lengthy line which I have drawn is positive and a short line which I have drawn is negative. Okay, so I am going clockwise. I am going from positive of the E1 to the negative of the E1, one full round. So E1 is positive. Next, what I'll do is I will separate the variables I1 and I2. So I1 I'll write one side, R1 plus R3 into I1, plus I will write I2 in the other side, R3 into I2 equals to E1 equals to E1. Let us call it as equation number 1. Okay, so this is equation number 1. I applied Kirchhoff voltage law for the loop 1, and I separated the variables I1 and I2. Next, I am applying the Kirchhoff voltage law for loop 2. And let me apply the KVL for the loop 2. Yes, this time I am going anti-clockwise to avoid the negative sign here. I am also going anti-clockwise. So current is also going anti-clockwise. Okay. So first circuit element, I reached R2, R2 into I2. It is plus R2 into I2, and I am coming down I1 plus I2 into R3. Okay. So this is equal to E2. I am going from positive of the E2 to the negative of E2. So it is plus again, plus E2 in the right hand side. So R2 I2 plus I1 plus I2 into R3 is equal to E2. Okay. So I applied Kirchhoff voltage law for loop 2. Now what next? I just separate the variables. I1 I will write one side, I2 I will write other side. So these two variables here are I1 and I2. So if I separate the variables, it is R3 I1 plus R2 plus R3 into I2 is equal to 0. Let us call it as equation number 2. Now I have two equations, then two variables. So what are those two equations? Equation 1, which I got by applying KVL for loop 1, and equation number 2, which I got by applying Kirchhoff voltage law for the loop 2. Now there are two variables and two equations can easily solve. Two variables here are I1 and I2. Okay, two variables, two equations is enough, you can solve it. If we have three variables, you need three equations to solve the same. Okay, if you have four variables, you need four equations to solve it. Okay, to get the value of that variable. So now we have two variables, now two equations are enough. Fine, I generated two equations by applying KVL for these two loops. I got two equations, so it is sufficient enough, I can solve this. But the simple rule and the simple way you can solve these two equations is by applying Cramer's rule. I have, in the last video itself, I have explained how to apply a Cramer's rule, and this time also I will repeat it. I'll repeat how to apply this particular rule for these two equations. Right. So if I want one variable I1, if I want I1, so you need to write a ratio here, you need to write a fraction here. So in the numerator you have one matrix, in the denominator you have another matrix. In the numerator matrix, you first write the constant values and then the coefficient of I2. Okay, in the numerator matrix, while applying Cramer's rule, first write the constants of the two equation and then write the coefficient of I2 of the two equation. So what are the constants of equation 1 and 2? In the equation 1, constant is E1. In the equation 2, constant is E2. Okay, fine. So constants I have written as E1 and E2. Next, I have to write the coefficient of I2 in the second column of the numerator matrix. Now the coefficient of I2 here is R3. Here in the equation 2, the coefficient of I2 is R2 plus R3. So I got R3 and R2 plus R3. I have done with the numerator. Constants and the coefficient of I2. I have written the constants and the coefficient of I2. Fine. Numerator is done. Now I have to write the denominator. Here, while writing the denominator, the first column will be the coefficients of I1 and second column will be the coefficient of I2. That remains same, that will not change. The denominator matrix, whether you go for finding I1 or you go for finding I2, but the denominator matrix will remain same. So what will be our denominator matrix? It is the coefficient of I1 and the coefficient of I2. Slowly we substitute the things in the denominator matrix. Coefficient of I1, what is here I1 coefficient? R1 plus R3. And what is in the equation 2? It is R3. Students, you only look for equation 1 and equation 2, okay? Right. So it is R1 plus R3, here it is R3. Now in the second column, you have to look for coefficient of I2. Here I2 coefficient is R3, and in the second equation 2, the coefficient is R2 plus R3. Now, so done. So I have written both the matrix, one numerator matrix. First I have written the constants. Second, I have written the coefficients of I2 because I want I1. If you want I1, write the coefficients of other variable in the numerator. Okay, constants one side, coefficient of I2 in the other side. In the denominator, coefficient of I1 and coefficient of I2. Done. Okay, right. Now it is time to expand this. So you know how to expand the matrix, diagonal multiplication, E1 into R2 plus R3 minus E2 into R3. Now, if I expand this, E1 into R2 plus R3 is E1 R2 plus E1 R3 minus, and this diagonal multiplication is E2 R3. Okay, so numerator is done. Now in the denominator, again diagonal multiplication, R1 R3 into R2 plus R3. If I expand this, R1 R2 plus R1 R3, then R3 R2 plus R3 square, then minus this diagonal multiplication is R3 square minus R3 square. So there are two R3 square, one is plus R3 square and minus R3 square will get cancelled in the denominator. So numerator it will remain same. See, look at the denominator. Denominator is simply R1 R2 plus R1 R3 plus R2 R3, and this can be written as sigma R1 R2, where the sigma runs from 1 to 3. Okay, so you know this, how to write a summation, how to write a sigma like this. Okay, all right, I got the equation for the current I1. What is actually the current I1? Look back and see. I1 is the current which is flowing through R1. Still, I need to calculate R2, which is current flowing through I2. I need to calculate I2, and then I can go for calculating I1 plus I2, which is the current which is flowing through R3. Right. Still, what I have to do is I have to calculate I2. So, for calculating I2, I have told you the same Cramer's rule. Matrix in the numerator, first constants and coefficient of I1. In the denominator matrix, coefficients of I1 and coefficient of I2. Let us expand this, cross multiply. It is E1 R3 plus E2 R1 minus E2 R3 divided by the same matrix. In the denominator, I am getting the same matrix what I got while calculating I1. Same denominator matrix. So in the denominator, I will get the same answer. R1 R2 R1 R3 plus R3 R2 plus R3 square minus R3 square will get cancelled. Again, that can be written as sigma R1 R2. Okay, I have written as sigma R1 R2 in the denominator, exactly what I have written for the equation I1. Okay, so I got I1 and I2. Now let us find the current which is flowing through R3 by summing these two, I1 plus I2. If I do that, the denominator of both I1 and I2 are same. So I can write the denominator as sigma R1 R2. Now look for the I1, E1 R2, E1 R3 minus E2 R3. E1 R3 plus E2 R3 minus E2 R3. So there are few things which cancel out, and I will left with E1 R2 plus E2 R3 divided by sigma R1 R2. This is equation 1. So I got equation 1. I got current which is flowing through R3 in complex network with two batteries. One step is over. I have found the current which is flowing through the one circuit element R3 with both the batteries together. And that current is E1 R2 plus E2 R3 divided by sigma R1 R2. So half of the job is done. Next half would be finding the current through the same R3 with one battery shorting the other, and with the other battery shorting this one. Let me do that. Okay. Now in the second step, I need to analyze this with the superposition theorem. Now I'll go with the help of the superposition theorem. I'll take only the battery E1. I will short circuit this E2. Now E2 is short circuited. I have only the battery E1. Now my aim, my job is to find out the current through R3 with only battery E1. Okay, in the next step I will take only E2 and I'll find the current which is flowing through R3. Okay, right, we'll do that. So for this, to find the current which is flowing through R3, you need to find a main current. The main current means current which is drawn from the battery. Current drawn from the battery is simple Ohm's law. It is voltage divided by resistance. Voltage, we know it is E1. E1 is the only battery we have, and the voltage is E1 divided by resistance. What shall I put for the resistance? Because I have three resistors, R1, R2, R3. Okay, I have combination of resistors. Now you see which is in series and which is in parallel. For the current, I is the current which flows through R1, and after flowing through R1, it get two branches, R2 and R3. There the current divides. So R2 and R3 are parallel for this current. R1 is in series. So simply you can write this as R1 plus R2 R3 divided by R2 plus R3. If the two are in parallel, you have to write R2 R3 divided by R2 plus R3. If it is in series, write plus R1. Okay. You know what is the effective resistance when the two resistors are in series. You know what is the effective resistance when two resistors are in parallel. I hope that you know all these things. When the two resistors are in series, it is simply R1 plus R2. When the two resistors are in parallel, it is R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. I hope you all know this. Okay, R2 and R3 are in parallel. Therefore, I have to write R2 R3 by R2 plus R3. Now R1 is in series, so I just added that, so it is plus R1. So I have found the main current, the current which is drawn from the battery, which is equal to the voltage divided by resistance. This time I have three resistors which are connected in a complex manner. I took effective resistance. Now the branch current. Now branch current, I have a formula. For the branch current, you people have studied that in a second PUC. The branch current formula is the main current into resistance in the another branch divided by sum of the two resistances. This is a very famous formula you derived in the second PUC as well. Okay, so branch current is equal to main current into resistance in the another branch divided by sum of the two resistances. So let us apply this branch current formula and find out the current which is flowing through R3. So I1 is equal to main current is I into resistance in the another branch. We have a two branches, R2 and R3. I am looking at R3. What is the other branch? R2 is the other branch. So write R2. I into R2 divided by sum of the two resistances. We have two branches, R1, R2 and R3. So sum of the two resistance is R2 plus R3. Now, what is the main current which we calculated earlier? Substitute that. The main current is E1 divided by R1 plus R2 R3 by R2 plus R3. There it is small letter I, here it is capital letter I. Don't mistake. Okay, they both are the same main current. Okay, substitute it. E1 by R1 plus R2 R3 by R2 plus R3 into this R2. The resistance in another branch divided by sum of the two resistances, R2 plus R3. Now let us simplify this. Take an LCM, R2 plus R3, and this R2 plus R3 cancel with that R2 plus R3. We have E1 R2 divided by this. It is E1 R2 divided by sigma R1 R2. I can write this R1 R2 plus R2 R3 plus R3 R1 as sigma R1 R2, where sigma runs from 1 to 3. Okay, so I got the branch current I1 with only one battery E1. I have calculated the current which is flowing through R3 with only one battery E1, and that is I1. Okay, now in the second B, I am calculating the current through same R3 with other battery E2, and this E1 is short circuited. Okay, now E1 is short circuited. I am looking for the current which is flowing through R3 again. Again you go apply same steps, same procedure and get the main current and find the equation for the branch current. So main current, I told you the same formula, it is the Ohm's law, total voltage by total resistance. Total voltage, we have only E2 divided by, we have three resistors in a complex manner. The current is coming like this, it passes R2, R2 is in series, and here at this junction it divides. So R1 and R3 are the two branches which are parlallel. Now this time R1 and R3 are parallel, R2 is in series. So therefore R1 R3 by R1 plus R3, because they are in parallel, plus R2. Right. Now branch current formula, I have told you that the branch current is the main current into resistance in another branch by sum of the two resistances. So this time other branch is R1. So we have two branches here, one is R1 and R3. I am looking for R3, so other branch is R1. So resistance in the another branch is R1 divided by sum of the two resistances, R1 plus R3. Now apply the main current here and you simplify, take the LCM, R1 plus R3 will be the LCM, that R1 plus R3 cancel with this R1 plus R3. You will get equation for I2 as E2 R1 by sigma R1 R2. Yes. Now I really applying the superposition theorem and I am finding the current through R3. Okay, it says that the current with two or more batteries, the current through any part of the network is equal to the algebraic sum of the current or voltage in that part of the network produced by each source. So each source will produce a current of I1 and I2, which with two batteries together will produce a current of I. So according to the superposition theorem, it is clear that I is equal to I1 plus I2. So let us take the sum of these two. I is the current, it's supposed to be the current across the same R3 with the both batteries together. Now with the basic law which I have calculated, the equation 1, go back and see the equation 1 which I have calculated. Yes. This equation 1 which I have calculated the current through R3 with the basic laws, Kirchhoff voltage law, I got this equation for current through R3 with both the batteries. Now in the second section what I did was I applied this superposition theorem and I find I1 and I found I2 and I took I1 plus I2 and this is the current flowing through R3 with both the batteries together. So first section I applied Kirchhoff voltage law and I find the current. Second section I applied this superposition theorem and I find the current. So these two currents are exactly same, are exactly matching. Therefore, the equation 1 which I found the current across the R3 with both the batteries together by applying a very basic Kirchhoff voltage law is exactly matching with the equation 2 which I calculated according to the superposition theorem. So then it is very much clear that the superposition theorem is proved because equation 2 and equation 1 are exactly matching. So this proves the superposition theorem. So thank you very much.